It is said that October in Texas almost makes up for August. But as the NHRA invades Texas Motorplex in Dallas, Texas, the temperatures are in the 90s. And with only three races remaining in the countdown to the championship, the heat really is on deep in the heart of Texas. There are a total of 451 points still on the table over the next three national events. 130 of those are on the line right now at the Texas Motorplex, home of the AAA Texas Fall Nationals. But to get the maximum amount of points, you've got to push your car to maximum. That is something one Texas Top Fuel racer has excelled at this season. That man with John Kernan.
As the Top Fuel points leader, Steve Torrence certainly has the bullseye square on his back. Everybody out here wants to beat him. And when you factor in that he's never won in his home state of Texas in Top Fuel, the pressure must be on. What's it like?
You know, we've had that same pressure on us all year for quite a while. And coming here to Texas, this is a hometown race, so we got a lot of support and a lot of fans and friends out here cheering for us. We're pretty confident, and I feel that pressure is just something we thrive on. We everybody's shooting for us, and we just got to keep going. And I think that hopefully we can get it done, but we just got to go rounds and let the points take care of themselves.
Now, what pressure down here? After all, this guy has already won the biggest race of his life, beating cancer.
And when Steve Torrence won St. Louis 2 weeks ago, he became the 10th driver to win eight or more national events in Top Fuel history. The previous nine of those all went on to a championship. So, Tony Pedregon, who does Steve Torrence need to be looking at the rearview mirror at?
Well, you still have to consider seriously Brittany Force. She is well within striking range. But look at Antron Clay, Tony Schumacher, Leah Pritchett. They all realize that this is a must-win weekend for them.
Hey, eight is the same number by the funny car points leader. A driver joined by Amanda Busick looking to cap another incredible year.
After 20 seasons, Ron Capps won his first championship trophy in funny car after not winning a single race in the countdown. This season, the defending champ already has two countdown wins on his resume and over a two-round lead on Robert Height. And Ron, how comfortable are you now in comparison to this point last year?
We're about the same as last year, honestly. We didn't have a race win last year, but we were battling with my teammates Tommy Johnson, Matt Hagen last year about this time. We're not comfortable. The way that we're looking at it is it's a race to Las Vegas. And when you leave Las Vegas, it's however cushion you might have or how far you're behind going into Pomona. You got to remember Pomona, it's 191 points available for somebody to snatch up. So whether or not you got a couple rounds, that's not very much. So we're going to just race Dallas, we're going to race Vegas, and pretend that's the championship. Go to Pomona and race that as one race. And Napa Auto Care guys have done a great job already, and we'll just see what happens.
It's the ninth time somebody has eight wins or more in a single season in funny car, but Ron Capps just the third driver. Tony Pedregon, you're one of those. Capps, though, certainly not feeling comfortable yet in going back-to-back.
Well, and the reason Ron isn't is he knows the potential of Courtney Force, Matt Hagen, Jack Beckman, like the drivers in Top Fuel. They need to have a good weekend, but they also need for Capps and Robert to cooperate and lose early.
But that, of course, on Sunday. Right now, it's all about qualifying, setting the stage for race day. This funny car kicks off with Daniel Wilkerson, that good-looking Summit Racing equipment machine, alongside of Todd Simpson, a Ponder, Texas native. Tony, have you ever pondered how far Ponder is? It's just a little bit, 80 miles. It's actually close, but Texas, a big state. Take a look at Tim Wilkerson's, wow, son, blew it up big time through the lights. Kid who made his debut in 2009, had his hands full then. In his first race since last year at the 4-wide, just blew that car to smithereens.
We take a close look at it right near the finish line. It not only blew the motor up, but it blew the front of the windshield out. So that's one of the bigger concussions that I've seen. There's a burst panel on the front of the car that's designed to relieve some of the pressure, but so much pressure, it blew a lot of the, not just the supercharger, and the front of the body. You can see a big crack here on that side of it. But a lot of damage to this body. This was freshly painted for the opening, the grand opening of the Summit facility here in Texas.
Obviously concerned for Daniel Wilkerson, making sure the fire is out. That body probably severely damaged already. Does not want to have it be any worse. While the NHRA safety safari is quick on the scene, let's look at it again. Watch the right side of your screen.
Well, this car was moving. It was actually on a very good run, but right at the finish line. It wasn't just the supercharger. A lot of the smoke coming out of the engine, that means there's a lot of damage to the short block. More than likely, some rods that have come out, some oil has pushed out of the exhaust manifold anytime it relieves the pressure from the supercharger.
Watching super slow motion. Wow. Big time concussion. Look at the fuel and the fire spraying in on Daniel Wilkerson, the son of Tim Wilkerson. You saw him climb out, very disgusted.
Well, right now, Dan is driving this thing on instinct. He can't see. The injectors really obstructs a lot of the vision, but you had that burst panel that was in front of him. So he was looking out of his peripheral vision. I'm sure that he was on the fire bottles, but this is pretty frustrating because if it's still burning underneath there, it's delaminating the body. They can't get it up, really, because of the engine damage.
Daniel is a chip off the old block, just like his dad, Tim Wilkerson, able to wheel these cars. And I mentioned that huge wreck, it came in Memphis 2009. Watch the right wheel, both wheels actually come off. It was in the right hand lane when one spun off, the other one then spun off after that. After that, he's just along for the ride.
Well, that was a frontal impact. Really, the way these chassis are designed, they're built like a passenger car to some degree, that the front is designed to absorb most of the energy, and the chassis really did what it was supposed to. And Dan, of course, was able to walk out of that incident.
And Amanda Busick is there with him now.
Guys, as you can see behind me, Daniel Wilkerson is on his first run in this funny car. It's up in smokes. And Daniel, you said you turned it off. You did not turn it off. The explosion happened right at the end. What did you feel inside the funny car?
It just banged right when I was shutting the throttle. I hit my button for the chutes. I was shutting the throttle to throw the chutes with my hand, and it just banged.
Now, Daniel, you work on cars. Have you been able to assess the damage yet?
It's bad. We only got one body, and I think that body's junk. So I don't know if we can run one of Tim's, or it's a shame for the Summit guys. It's a beautiful Summit Texas body. God, it's a shame. The thing was awesome. It's delaminated on the side. I can see now, too, from the fire. So that body's junk. It's a shame.
So an explosive start to our Dallas action. Also will include big news this week coming in Nitro involving this woman. Part one broke on Monday, while part two involving this guy breaks when we come back to the Texas Motorplex. Stand by. Not going to want to miss this announcement. Funny car qualifying continuing here at the AAA of Texas NHRA Fall Nationals. Big announcement made on Monday involving Alexis DeJoria. The place where it all began back in 2011, she announced on Monday that at the conclusion of 2017, she will step away from NHRA competition. She said, quote, "It's one of the hardest decisions I've ever had to make, and I will miss everyone so much. My reasoning behind this decision is simple. It's time for me to switch my focus towards my family." So five national event wins, a U.S. Nationals winner. No one can take that away from her. We'll have more with Alexis as part of our NHRA Today coverage that kicks off our Sunday coverage at 1 p.m. Eastern. That's the bittersweet portion of what has been an interesting week in funny car, Tony.
Well, the rest is going to come from a current top 10 top fuel driver that we had in the booth a couple of weeks ago. And to think he threw a bone to us and we pursued
coy,
it.
Yeah.
But he's waiting a couple of weeks. And, well, let's hear the rest from this driver.
Well, I believe the question posed to Sean Langdon 2 weeks ago was, would you drive a Nitro car with an engine in front of you? You kind of beat around the bush. Now I'm going to ask you that same question, Sean Langdon. Will you drive a Nitro car with an engine in front of you? Talk
Absolutely.
To me, brother. When?
Next year.
Say it ain't so. You're switching to funny car.
Yep, we're switching to funny car. We're going to bring global electronic technology. And basically, I mean, we got it all set in place. So it's an exciting time. I mean, it's a big move, but I feel like it's a good point in my career to make the switch.
Sean, you're the funny car driver. You got to help him out here.
Well, Sean, let me ask you a question. Do you guys plan on doing any testing before year's end, or is all the testing for you in the seat of a funny car going to take place early next year?
Well, our plan right now is to get my license after Vegas this year, and then obviously go to testing in the beginning of next year. So we're just going to kind of take it step by step. You know, we still have our jobs to do this year with our own respective classes and cars that we're in. But the point is, you know, we want to get the license out of the way this year. Next year, we want to be ready to go as soon as we get into testing.
And one more question. Have you checked with NHRA Tech? Are they going to allow your beard in that funny car?
Good question.
I might have to trim it. I might get singed a little bit. I have no idea what to expect in this thing. I just sat in one for the first time last week. They lowered the body. I have no idea what to expect. So I'm just going with it. I'm excited about it. It's going to be a great opportunity, but it's going to be a big change, like I said, for me. So a lot of learning curves in the near future. A lot of questions I'm going to be asking, but I'm excited.
Welcome to the jungle.
Yeah, definitely look forward to that transition. Of course, a guy who won in the junior dragsters was also a Lucas Oil champion, as well as a Top Fuel World champion. Can't wait to see what it's like when you enter funny car next year. And, of course, that's an opportunity he only has because of two very important people standing by now with John Kernan.
Well, Dave, of course, you're talking about Samantha and Steve Bryson, the owners of Global Electronic Technology. And Steve, what was it about drag racing? What did you see here that made you and your company want to get involved?
You know, I'd have to say it was the Coletta team. I came out with the Galvins last year. Doug won Pomona. I wanted my name on the back of that car worse than I wanted anything at that particular point in time. So Samantha and I agreed that we would, you know, shift marketing dollars and see how it worked out. But then we came here and we fell in love with the fans. You know, the entire atmosphere in NHRA is like no other. The people here are crazy. Look around. You see a sea of pink everywhere, right? It's cancer. Everybody's, you know, pulling together. Oh, shout out to David Daniels battling lung cancer. So we're here. Good people. The sport is so exhilarating. You know, we're all old dragsters, all us old guys anyway, yeah. You know? We all grew up like that. So, you know, it's the cars, the excitement, and then the family atmosphere. We're here to stay. We're going to be here next year, and we're excited.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you asking.
Dave?
And just what is Global Electronic Technology? We're talking about credit card processing services. Rashawn Langdon figures to move into that funny car driven now by Alexis DeJoria. Breast cancer awareness, we're in the month of August, or excuse me, October rather. You're going to see a lot of that as Alexis stages up and next to the Sweden sensation, Johnny Lindbergh. Whoa. Left turn right away for Johnny. Alexis up in smoke. Boy, we've seen some things already, Tony.
Well, never a dull moment here in Dallas at this track, but Johnny Lindbergh, the car on the right side of the screen, more than likely, he not only lost fire in one cylinder, there were multiple cylinders that went out on the left bank, right side of our screen, and that was the reason that the car made a hard turn. Alexis just lost traction instantly.
And again, more with Alexis on our NHRA Today coverage that kicks off Sunday at 1 p.m. Eastern. What will happen next? The crowd waits to see as Cruz Pedregon brings no round wins in the countdown up against Tim Wilkerson, who just saw his son, Dan, have big time problems. What must be going through his mind in the Toyota lane?
Tim Wilkerson, he's got enough experience that he knows where he has to be mentally to get this car down the track. But right now they're just trying to make the right decisions to make good runs.
401 for Tim. Parachutes come out. No problems with the car there. Let's quickly go down to John.
You know, you were wondering about the body for Daniel Wilkerson. He only has the one Summit body, but Tim does have a spare body on the truck. They will wait until all of the qualifying action is done on Friday, today, before they make a decision, probably tomorrow morning, as to whether they're going to put that other body, the backup body for Tim, on Daniel's car for tomorrow.
So time will tell there. Time will tell also what ultimately is the number one qualifying mark. John Force, the last man to go back-to-back, did it in 2002, but Ron Capps, 2016 champ, hopes to change that as Funny Car Qualifying continues from Texas. Back at the 32nd annual AAA Texas NHRA Fall Nationals. We're just outside of Dallas, Texas, and it just hit me. Tony Pedregon, it is Friday the 13th. That explains some of the things that we've seen already. And the fact that J.R. Todd is not on the starting line right now alongside of Tommy Johnson Jr. He just went down the track after the burnout.
Well, if you're superstitious, you can see that problem set in for J.R. Todd. Now, there's a good chance that a reverser didn't work. Something in the idle may not have been right, but he opted to get off of the track. Now, he has to be completely off the track before Tommy makes his run, but it appears that they've done so.
Did I mention we also had a lengthy oil down? More than an hour. And now Tommy Johnson Jr. slides his way down through the 1,000-foot track at 4.149 seconds, 236 miles an hour. We now have had 11 cars go down, 10 have received scores, and Bob Tasca is the number one qualifier right now at 3.941. We'll have some highlights for you from that in just a little bit, but right now it's John Force and Jack Beckman, and of course you can't come to Dallas, Texas and not be reminded of the iconic moment that happened to the 16-time champion John Force here running alongside of Kenny Bernstein. And this wasn't for a championship moment.
Well, this action took place in the second round. Keep an eye on Kenny Bernstein as he gets close to that block near the end of the track.
That's when chaos breaks loose. The cameras naturally think that John Force is part of the car, but as the front half of that car comes to a stop near the sand trap, you realize, where's John? John's in the backside of that wreckage, tucked up against the wall, hurt big time. He would be choppered out. He would be off the racetrack until the following year. But John Force now back in that same lane.
has problems. Jack Beckman goes 3.914 seconds to reset the number one qualifying effort. Tony, you were down at that top end when that chopper was leaving. I remember you being there. It shook everybody up in the sport for quite a while.
Yeah, really, at that stage, none of us really knew the degree of injuries that John had. You know, I was yelling out into the chopper. I didn't know if I would see him again, but it was a very eerie feeling. But on the racetrack, Jack Beckman just showed all of us that there's still some bite out there in this 91-degree weather, setting quick time of this session so far.
All right, here's Bob Tasca along with Jeff Deal. We said this was the number one qualifying pass until just a moment ago when Jack Beckman reset that. Lisa Deal, that's the surfer's wife, gets him ready to go. And of course, all of this chaos happening after Daniel Wilkerson had already had his issues. This was the next pair, in fact, after Wilkerson's big explosion in that Texas Summit Equipment car. Look at Task in the left-hand lane. No problems in that Ford. So he goes 3.941, and that stood as the number one until just a few moments ago. Mentioned Friday the 13th. Just some crazy, wacky things happening so far to kick off the Fall Nationals. So next up, it's going to be the Pennzoil runner. That's Matt Hagan running alongside the Advanced Auto Parts October Breast Cancer Awareness Machine, belonging to Courtney Force. You think Courtney still has a shot? She is third in the standings. For Matt Hagan, fourth in the standings, it has to be a get healthy weekend, John Kernan.
Yeah, absolutely right. Talking to his crew chief, Dickie Venables, earlier in the afternoon, they have not given up on the possibility of winning Matt another championship. Dickie basically says they've made some wrong tuning calls. They've got a great car, and whenever they hit the tune-up right, it runs really well. But they've also had some bad luck. So Dickie's trying to make the right calls on track conditions, maybe not each time trying to set, you know, the world on fire to set a new record.
Tony, speaking of superstitions, when you start talking about luck, there's good luck, there's bad luck. Do you believe in any of that?
Well, you have a tendency to, but, you know, in the end, these tuners, they really don't. They are able to evaluate what they did at the previous race. And, you know, Dickie's one of those tuners that has had a lot of success, specifically at this racetrack, the two following racetracks that we're going to be at, Vegas and Pomona. But both of these teams on the starting line really understand that they have to come out of here with the win. If their opponents that are ahead of them in the points lose early, even better. But a win is really the only thing that's going to do these teams some good.
That's not the way the Pennzoil team wants to start. Meanwhile, Courtney, 3.928, goes to the number two spot. Qualifying's not been that team's bugaboo. She's been number one at seven races this year. That's a career best, but now winless in well over a year. She's still very much, though, a part of this countdown.
Well, right side of the screen, Matt Hagan, he really didn't go. In fact, the car didn't go 60 feet. It actually launched. You can see the car, flawless run for Courtney, but watch Matt Hagan here. Listen to the engine RPM. Car instantly revved up, and you know, he's out of power. This is qualifying. If this were race day, he would have followed up and tried to get that car to recover. Courtney Force would have still been off to the races, but they're gonna lose out on some bonus points. They're gonna have to assess what happened on that run, and they know the better session is coming up in a few hours from now.
And that'll bring us to the final pair to wrap up the first qualifying sessions. Robert Height, Ron Capps have completed the burnouts at the starting line, but at the top end, that's where we find Amanda Busick.
Jack, you're currently in the number one spot. There are three races left in the countdown, and you find yourself fifth in the point. Do you think there's still time?
Well, it depends what Capps and Height do. They would have to struggle. I mean, the way they've been running in the regular season and in the countdown, I don't know that we could catch them. But you never give up until they say that there's no chance of it. And remember, Pomona will be points and a half. If we win three races, whatever they do is wherever they'll end up. We can't control that. I'm hopeful, and I can't wait to get back in the car tonight.
Well, when it comes to Ron Capps, keep in mind he becomes just the third driver in funny car history to ever win eight or more races in a single season. It's something that John Force has done six times. Tony Pedregon, back in 2003, you did that. You grabbed eight wins. 14 years separated your mark from Ron Capps' mark, and he hopes it's enough to win the championship like everybody else did. And how about that? Again, Friday the 13th, an anticlimactic way to wrap up funny car qualifying session number one, but the bonus points go to Beckman, Courtney Force, and Bob Tasca. And with that, Funny Cars goes back to the pits, begins working on it for session two, and Top Fuel comes to the lanes next. What will happen? It's a wild, wacky Friday the 13th here at the AAA Texas Fall Nationals. Right now, it's NHRA Mellow Yellow drag racing action from Dallas, Texas. But coming up, first pitch tonight at 8 p.m. Eastern, game one of the ALCS. Of course, we will kick it off with MLB pregame. We're talking about Houston welcoming the Yankees to Houston. Yeah, the Astros won 10 more in the regular season, but if Aaron Judge gets hot, don't discount the Yankees.
And Aaron Judge is either hot or he's not. Am I understanding that right?
True. That is very true. But right now, let's focus right here in Dallas, Texas on Top Fuel. Blake Alexander back in the Worsham Racing Top Fuel Dragster on the left. And the Capco machine, if you're thinking Steve Torrence, think again. Stevie's got a blocker. Dad Billy is out in the Toyota lane. First appearance for him since 2015, and he plans to run the last three events to help his son.
Well, and this team did some testing in Indy. This car ran very well. They blew a motor up, but if they can pick up where they left off in testing, look for a good, strong qualifying run here.
Not a strong start for him, not a strong start for Blake either. Blake turned on the red light, but in qualifying, that does not matter. Lanes are individually timed, and those are times that neither one of them are going to want to remember by the time this weekend's done. Alexander temporarily number one. Billy Torrence goes 9-24 with more on Billy. Here's Mr. Birthday Boy, John Kernan. Happy birthday, John.
Hey, thank you very much, Dave. Billy is out here for three reasons. One, you said blocking for his son, Steve. Two, to have a great time because he enjoys doing this. But three, looking ahead to next year, he's trying out some different clutch packs throughout these final three races of the season to give Steve's team a head start on next year. Remember, they started off slowly earlier this year because they had just switched some clutch discs out.
So we'll see how he handles that. And of course, if you caught up with Lewis Bloom's NHRA.com interview with him from out in Glendora in the Wally Park studio, he asked him point blank. He says, if you guys come head to head, your kid needs that round win, what are you gonna do? He says, we're gonna race. The Lord's will, it's the Lord's will, my kid wins a championship. It's a good answer.
Well, I think it's interesting to clarify the term blocker. I mean, really, he's a terminator when he's coming out here. You want to eliminate some of the competition when he goes up against some of those cars that are close to Steve Torrence. Well, it's going to be Billy's job to try to eliminate them.
So Kevin Kinsley comes to the starting line next. The Arlington, Texas guy. That's just right down the road. You know, Texas is a big state, but Arlington, that's bona fide close up against Richie Crampton. Transplant Australian, now naturalized American citizen, this Seal Master car. You've been away from drag racing for a while and you think, hey, that's Troy Coughlin Jr. that drives that car. He got out of the seat right before the U.S. Nationals. They inserted Richie Crampton and haven't looked back since. Crampton, much like, I guess, Billy Torrence, you know, figures to be a blocker, a terminator, a thorn in countdown racer sides. And if he can do anything he can to help Doug Coletta exercise a 20-year championship winless streak, that's what he wants to do.
Yeah, and Richie Crampton really getting in the seat of this Sealmaster car has really eliminated one of the variables. You know, Troy Coughlin Jr. had some issues steering the car. Not the case. They have had some mechanical problems. In the other lane for Kevin Kinsley, the last time we saw this car was final round at the biggest race of the year. They looked awful impressive, and the only thing that kept them from giving Steve Torrence a good race was they had some breakage with the blower pulley. And let's see if they can fix that and address that here.
Seal Master car with problems, same story for Richie Crampton. Let's face it, again, the heat is up in Texas, well above 90 degrees. It's 120 on the racetrack. And again, all those little bonus points that maybe don't fit into these guys in their championship hopes, everybody wants to run as hard as they possibly can. First qualifying session is a reverse order of points. So as we get further along, the higher in points we climb. We're not quite to the top 10 as Troy Buff brings the Bill Miller Engineering car to the starting line alongside of Sean Reed, eighth race of the season in the Peyton family car. What do these guys got to do to give these people here something to cheer about in Texas?
Well, they saw a lot of funny cars that did not get down the racetrack. There are a couple that did. They ran extremely well. You have to factor in the conditions, the weather conditions. So what these teams have to specifically do is go into that bell housing, take some of the weight off of the clutch. Now, also on the pressure plate, there are these little mechanisms called bandits. Now, back 20 years ago, they used to actually pull some of the lockup levers out. What the bandits do, if they sue a set screw in, it actually takes some of the lockup levers out of play. So they need to lighten up the clamp on the clutch as this car starts to accelerate down the track. Don't detune them. You got to keep the motor buzzing and plow through the clutch if you can.
Look at Sean Reed. That's a pretty representative pass at 386. just about 500s off of his career best. And the Lake Taps Washington runner goes number one, 386, and better than 318. Great job by that Peyton family car. Top Fuel qualifying gets only better when we come back, as we will crack into the top 10, bring the high horsepower cars like Leah Pritchett, that was the record holder until Clay Milliken upset that a couple of weeks ago. We will also see Steve Torrence, a Texas native, the Capco Contractors driver, trying to hold on to number one. Sean Langdon, Scott Palmer. We're talking about Top Fuel qualifying session number one at the 32nd annual AAA Texas NHRA Fall Nationals. First original all-concrete super stadium, if you will, built for drag racing by Billy Meyer. It certainly is a great place to showcase speed, power, and performance. We hope both of these do all three of those right now.
Well, on an all-concrete racetrack, what that allows is the pavement after about 600 feet. Typically, most racetracks that have the initial 600 feet of concrete transitions to pavement. Now, when this track gets
to asphalt,
when it gets real hot, it doesn't have a tendency to get loose. So what we're seeing right now is just a lack of rubber and an extreme amount of heat that really loosens the track up. So they make the proper clutch adjustments, they'll get good runs in.
Bonafide side-by-side pair, Sean Langdon goes to the top. 3.83 seconds, but look at 282 miles an hour, 297 for Scott Palmer. These are cars that were not under power through the finish line.
Well, there's a good chance when the drivers are in the seat, they can feel the G's fall off. The car is no longer accelerating. If they hear the engine revving up, that means the tire is starting to slip. Check out a good launch for Sean Langdon right here.
In our Toyota Super Slow-Mo. Look at those tires bobbling back there. On the cusp of shaking, but just didn't quite get there.
It's so slow. You can almost see the firing order. 184, 1864, 184, 263, whatever the firing order is, you can see they've switched the firing order on some of these cars. But this is a good, clean run up to the point that it got to about 800 feet, and he shut it out. But look at the heat waves on this car. And Sean Langdon, he's going to have a much different view from that perspective next year in that funny car.
If you're just joining us, you missed the top part of the show. That man, Sean Langdon, announced that next year he'll take Global Electronics Technologies, put it on the side of a Coletta-owned funny car. That same Coletta operation that's going to see Alexis DeJoria retire at the end of this year. That's Leah Pritchett. Great year for her. Make no bones about it. A solid year for Terry McMillan as well, as he's made the countdown for the first time ever in his career. Probably will be the first one to tell you that he should have had a race win out in Seattle. Actually outran Antron Brown in that final, but got beat by the hole shot. Halfway through the countdown, let's take a look at those drivers that have moved up, moved down, as well as earned the most points as far as moving down. Leah Pritchett, like I said, a very solid season. 4 wins, 6 starts from number one, 7 finals, but in the countdown just hasn't been able to put round wins together. Meanwhile, Doug Coletta and Brittany Force have moved up. In fact, Doug Coletta has actually earned more points than Steve Torrence has, the point leader.
Well, Doug Coletta is one of those drivers that's going to take it down to the last race. There's no question about that, along with Steve Torrence. But, you know, for Leah Pritchett and this team, you know, you can see Todd O'Gahar making the final adjustments, more than likely in what the car's idling at. They want these cars to idle at about 2,400 RPM. Any variation in that, if it's too low, it's not going to leave like he wants it to. 100 RPM or even 50 RPM too much, that could cause the car to lose traction instantly. But he really feels that he could make some better decisions in the heat. However, if the weather does what it's supposed to on Sunday, it's going to be a lot cooler. It will play into their hands.
Sunday, can't wait for that. There's the first 370 pass, 3.767 seconds, courtesy of Leah Pritchett, that goes to the number one spot. As Terry McMillan grabs the second qualifying position. 92nd race of her career. Keep in mind, she started in funny car and hopes to get herself back into this countdown chase. Needs to have a good weekend, and that means bonus points. Right now, she's eligible for those.
Well, left side of your screen, look at their little rooster tail that both these cars are kicking up, and the majority of that, some of it is the unburned fuel, but a lot of that is the clutch dust. Now, they're going to wear about 150 to 200 thousandths of material off of the disc as these cars accelerate down the racetrack, but the trend that we're going to see from this point on is the times are going to continue to improve because the tuners are able to read the racetrack, and the better they can read it by seeing cars go down in front of them, whether they're losing traction or making full runs, the better they can make the adjustments to adapt to these conditions.
Time now for our Evans Crew Chief Confidential, as Leah Pritchett's crew chief, Todd O'Gahar, has joined John.
Todd, we've seen a lot of teams struggle trying to get down the track. How'd you do it?
You know, we just did our thing, you know, not pay too much attention. You know, we knew the NHRA would do the right thing with the racetrack and make it all good. So we just did the temperature and did what we normally would do.
And it paid off.
Yes, it did, John. Wild, wacky stuff earlier today. Cars struggling to get down the racetrack, then a lengthy oil down of more than an hour. The NHRA safety so far had problems getting that oil to come out of the racetrack, but they would not put a car on this racetrack until it was right. And now that left lane starts to begin paying dividends. Here's Clay Milliken, the record setter from St. Louis, up alongside of Tony Schumacher. And for Tony Schumacher, it's been a great career. 8 times a champion, 83 national event wins, but the very first one of those coming right here at the AAA Texas NHRA Fall Nationals when he took the X-Side ride, crew chief then by Dan Olson, to his first ever win. And I guarantee if you'd asked him on that day, do you think you'll win at least 82 more times? That young pup, Tony Schumacher, would have said, I don't think so.
We should ask him, how do you eat an elephant one bite at a time?
Yes, you do. John Kernan.
Earlier this week, I was at Tony Schumacher's shop talking to his crew chief, Mike Green, and asked him, you know, it seems on the surface that they're struggling a little bit, not winning the rounds, not going rounds like we're used to seeing them do. So I asked him if he was going to make some major changes, try some new things out these final three races. He says, no way. We've got a good car. We've got a good tune-up. We just have to make the right calls.
It's all about a team coming together at the right time, something that they are very accustomed to over in that Army camp. Clay Milliken with a better time slip as we got side-by-side 370s here at the Texas Motorplex. Clay goes to number two, Tony Schumacher, number three at 3.793 seconds. And with that, suddenly we are down to just two pair of top fuel cars as Antron Brown quietly contemplates what he and the Matco Teals team will throw on this racetrack when we come back. It's the NHRA on FS1 from Texas.
We welcome you back to the Texas Motorplex. Top fuel qualifying continuing with Brittany Force and Antron Brown. And you might have wondered what in the world happened to the defending top fuel champion Antron Brown here in the countdown, not performing up to the standards that we would expect of them. So they stayed over at St. Louis, tested on Monday, found some things in the bell housing in that all-important clutch setup that they think will help them be a little more aggressive and run a lot better.
It is absolutely amazing to think that at this point, Antron Brown and his Matco Tools team have no bonus points from qualifying. And they're not going to get any here either. Brittany has her hands full with flame coming out the back through the finish line. Legs it, though, to a 377.5. At this point, good enough for third. At this point, good enough for one bonus point. Brittany Force starting the weekend, 83 back of Steve Torrance.
Well, look at your left side of the screen. Brittany Force, her car really starts to hunt around here. And you know, that car expired before it got to the finish line. And, you know, occasionally the engine, when it starts to see a lot of pressure, it'll actually shoot a little bit of oil out. It'll spray on the tires. That may or may not have been the case. A lot of times, as hot as it could be right now, it wasn't really glued to the track. But she did a good job getting it to the finish line and still a good run, even though there was fire coming out of the engine.
Final pair set to go now in front of the fans here at Texas Motorplex. Steve Torrance leads the points. 12 rounds of racing left. Doug Coletta is his closest pursuer at 42 points back. Home event for Steve Torrance as Bobby Lagana steps away. But for Doug Coletta and Jim Oberhofer, a chance to end a 20-year curse. Same thing that Ron Capps did last year, becoming the funny car champ. Bob, the hometown boy will have none of it. Steve Torrance running on me, 3.717, 320 miles an hour, 3 more bonus points as Doug Coletta garners none. We will talk to Steve Torrance when we come back as Nitro is now in the books, and when we come back, we'll have the story from Pro Stock, and that includes the Pro Stock car points leader Greg Anderson and Pro Stock Motorcycles lead man Fast Eddie Craywood. Good time still to come from the Texas Motorplex, the AAA Texas Fall Nationals. The countdown to ALCS Game 1 is on, but right now we've counted up to number one in top fuel. It happens to be a Texas native as the Capco kid, Steve Torrance, is at the top end with Amanda.
Steve Torrance, a half of a tenth on the field puts you in number one after the first qualifying session. A statement run here in front of a hometown crowd. You hopped out of your car and said you have some stuff to say.
Man, I tell you what, you know, Richard Hogan, Bobby Lagana, every one of those boys right there got the baddest race car in the bunch, and told him, old Papa John, maybe if he wants to deliver them pizzas a little faster, he better call Capco.
Kind of getting the idea that chemistry is indeed there and they are championship contenders.
Well, and they have momentum and they have confidence, and that's a dangerous thing with a few races to go, and their performance is really speaking for itself.
Pro stock qualifying. It all kicked off with Brian Self over in the right lane a few moments ago on an 88-degree day here at the Texas Motorplex. But watch this car spin the tires big time at the starting line, and that's going to cost Lump. That's his nickname. A little bit in the ET department, but at 6.717, that's the benchmark. Everybody gunning for him. Next up, it's Larry Morgan that would run alongside of Shane Tucker in that beautiful Hot Wheels Chevrolet, the Aussie.
Well, the conditions we're looking at, that not only the extreme heat, but the humidity is twice what it was from St. Louis that we did a couple of weeks ago. So a lot of the tuners are having to make the proper adjustments, not just with the chassis, but with the fuel systems as well.
Tucker again spins the tires in that right-hand lane. Meanwhile, Larry Morgan with a clean pass goes 6.67. Next up, that'll bring Val Schmelin. That's the KV racing machine on the left side of the racetrack up against the historical fencer, the American ethanol racer, Derek Kramer. We also call him the king of the burnouts from the U.S. Nationals. Hey, look at Kenny Delco. Excuse me, Val with a good pass to start. Derek Kramer straight down the groove as well. Derek qualifies in the number two spot as Val has a good start to the weekend at 682. I mentioned Kenny Delco. The car is virtually identical to Val's. Just a couple of paint swaps here and there. It's Kenny Delco in the left lane now against the gas monkey runner, Alex Laughlin. Same story for the left lane racer. Good pass to start the weekend, but not nearly as good as Alex Laughlin at 6.672 seconds. Goes to the number one spot, but we're getting closer and closer to cars and drivers in the top 10. Alan Przinski is not, but Chris McGahey is a top 10 runner, and he's a Texas native.
Well, some of these drivers and some of these teams are starting to think of some of those bonus points. They can get the three bonus points for being the quickest. You can see Alan Przinski off the starting line here. No Chris McGahey. He had some problems before he even got to the starting line.
6.76 seconds puts the New Jersey runner in the number six position, and that would bring us next up to Alan Johnson and Jake Coughlin. Gonna be tough to say goodbye to the marathon man, full-time racing at the end of this year in pro stock. But as of late, he's been running better, just not on this particular pass. Again, problems in the right lane for AJ as JC. Jake Coughlin goes 6.65.7 to take the top spot. Teammate Erica Enders comes to the starting line next. She's in the left lane alongside of Drew Skillman, the U.S. Nationals winner. You know, Drew Skillman's on a decent pass, but not nearly as decent as Erica, who goes to the top at 6.65.1, and the numbers just keep getting better and better and better. Big moment for Tanner Gray. Pretty Ricky, as we call him. But Pretty Ricky's getting pushed off the starting line. No bonus points for the 18-year-old. That couldn't come at a worse time, too. Championship contender trying to take on Jason Lyon, trying to keep up with Bo Butner, Greg Anderson, the top three right now.
Well, and the hit for that team is they have the potential to come out here and try to earn those 3 points, but not making a run is really going to hurt them. But as soon as they started this car, if it wasn't sounding right, rather than run the risk of hurting the motor, they've really made the wise decision to shut it down.
So now the attention will be placed on the blue Summit Chevrolet. Tanner gets pushed off. Remember, that's a young man who shows a lot of emotion and what possibly is going on inside and under the helmet right now for him as he has a missed opportunity here. Jason Lyon still looking to build off of one win this season that came all the way back at the first event of the season. That's hooked up and that's Holland, and that is now the number one qualifying mark at 6.639 seconds, better than 208 miles an hour. And that brings us to our final pair. It's Bo Butner that has led the points for much of the countdown, was the number one seed, but Greg Anderson took over the top spot. The gap between these two at the moment, just three simple points. Qualifying points could change things right here. And even though Greg crossed the finish line first, it's Bo Butner that gets number one, 6.634 seconds. Three valuable bonus points, and at the moment, he happens to be tied with Greg Anderson in the championship standings. Amanda Busick caught up with the Speed Dog racer after this run.
Bill, you're the number one qualifier after the first qualifying session here. You're the points lead. How's your confidence right now?
Great. great team. I mean, there's three cars here that's going to duke it out, probably two more coming up. So I won my first national event here in 99 ever. So it's been a long time since I won here. Let's keep it going. And these little points, we're trying to add them up. But let's have a good time, have fun.
Hey, factor in that qualifying position right now. Bo Butner, technically your points leader. It's the top six that we bring to you from Pro Stock Motorcycle, kicking off with Scott Polacek and Jerry Savoy, the defending champ, sixth and fifth in the points, respectively. Little wiggle there by the runner in the left-hand lane, but it didn't bother Scotty Polacek. Take a look at Jerry Savoy, though, at 687, going to the number one spot. Hector Rana Jr. sits fourth in the standings. Andrew Hines has been marching his way toward the top, currently sits in position number three. Good passes for each, but they're not touching number one.
Well, that run from Jerry Savoy, that's what everyone is going to be shooting for. It's going to be difficult. It's very hot. It's very humid. But you can see some of the cloud cover might be improving the track condition for these last two.
Final opportunity, Ellie Tonglet and Eddie Krawick, the points leader in the category. And how about Eddie Krawick, 6.860. He is number one after one and after this pass caught up with Amanda.
Low ET after Q1, Eddie Krawick. You're ahead of Ellie Tonglet by one round. What's your focus here this weekend?
Just got to go out there and make good laps each session. That was a very good clean lap for me right off the truck, nice and straight. Ran really well. We were close with the tune-up. We're going to only build from here. So it's about learning for race day and knowing what we need to do. So looks like Ennis is going to get like a cold front rolling in. So this stuff, don't count. Race day does.
Next up for the AAA Texas Fall Nationals, 1 p.m. Eastern Sunday for a special edition of NHRA Today, followed by the finals at 2 p.m. Eastern. Hey, now it's time for baseball. ALCS Game 1 between the Yankees and the Astros. Let's head out to Los Angeles now for our MLB on FS1 pregame. Bye-bye.